Meantime, here at home, White House turmoil and turnover. White House counselor Kellyanne Conway says she expects that the leaks will lead to personnel changes, i.e. firing, in the White House, in the West Wing, as the president takes to Twitter and calls the leakers traitors. And also new reporting this morning from our Caitlin Collins that the White House is struggling to enforce that personal cell phone ban, even conducting sweeps to try to clear out those devices. And just ahead, a meeting, a lunch meeting between the president and Senate Republicans could prove tense on two fronts. Let's begin there. Caitlin Collins joins us at the White House. So what's your new reporting on what they are trying to do to stop the leaks?
Well, Poppy, leaks are a very sensitive subject in this White House right now, with the president tweeting just yesterday that the leaks are a massive over-exaggeration put out by the fake news to make the administration look as bad as possible. He said, with that being said, of course, that the people who are leaking are traitors and cowards, and we will find out who they are. But Poppy, our new reporting shows that finding out who the leakers are is not that easy for this White House, and despite going to great lengths to do so, they've actually struggled to tamp down any leaks in the 16 months that they've been in office. One of those tactics was a personal cell phone ban instituted by the Chief of Staff John Kelly back in January. Now, when John Kelly outlined this policy in a memo to staffers, he said it wasn't to prevent them from being able to talk to reporters, but for a national security reason. But many people who work inside this White House saw it as a way to get them to stop being able to talk to reporters throughout the day. Now, the way that they carried this ban out was they had these lockers in the entryways into the West Wing where staffers store their phones throughout the day. You can often find several staffers huddled around these lockers checking their phones throughout the day. And staffers or sources inside the White House tell me that these lockers are constantly buzzing and chirping because people's phones are going off. Now, for people who forget to put their phones in the locker or simply ignore the ban, there are sweeps carried out in the West Wing to check if there are any unauthorized devices that aren't government issued anywhere in the West Wing. That includes these several men dressed in suits going throughout the West Wing, having these handheld devices roughly the size of iPads that can pick up if a non-authorized phone is in the West Wing. They're very accurate, I'm told, by people inside the West Wing, and can even tell if it's an Apple iPhone or a Samsung Galaxy, just to show you what great lengths they are going to find out if there are these unauthorized devices here in the West Wing. Now, in this memo that John Kelly sent to staffers, he said that no one would be, or people could be prohibited from coming into the West Wing if they did have these unauthorized devices. But sources inside the White House said they did not believe anyone would be fired as a result of that. Of course, we did have Kellyanne Conway last night saying that she believed there would be personnel changes in light of the recent leaks here in the White House, Poppy. But the bottom line is staffers inside the White House talk to reporters. The president himself talks to reporters, and that's how reporters can find out what's going on in the White House to tell the American people.
Caitlin Collins at the White House with all that reporting. Thank you. Let's go to Capitol Hill. Suzanne Malveaux is there. Look, the president's going to have this lunch meeting with some leading Republicans, and some leading Republicans are pretty confused and upset about the McCain comments out of the White House, and confused about why the president is trying to help prop up this Chinese tech company, ZTE. What should we expect?
Well, Poppy, it's really quite frustrating for a lot of members of Congress here. This is day six that this story exists now, whether the White House is going to publicly apologize or we'll see something publicly from Kelly Sandler. A lot of people privately are saying that this is the last thing that they want to talk about, but also they've been talking about this publicly. We saw from the leadership, Senate leadership, Lindsey Graham speaking about it, as well as Senators Cornyn and John Thune. They've all been saying, look, that the White House, either Sandler herself or the administration, needs to publicly apologize for this really awful joke of dying Senator John McCain, that is just distracting them from what really they need to focus on at this point. We heard from Senator John Kennedy in his colorful way saying sometimes, you know, there's a reason for everything, and sometimes that reason is that you're just stupid. And so that is one thing that's going to come up here in this closed meeting. The other thing, of course, is that giant Chinese telecommunications corporation and the break that the president says he's going to give ZTE. They want to know more about that. Cornyn also saying that this is a company that is guilty of cyber theft and espionage, that they are not on the same page with the president. The president, for his part, he is very frustrated about the slow pace of judicial nominees getting through. He wants to see that pushed forward in a faster pace, and also is going to be pushing for more funding for his border wall. Poppy.
There's a lot there. Suzanne Melveaux, thank you very much. With me now to break it all down, our political analyst Alex Burns and our contributor Bianca Goladriga. Thank you both. So, Alex, let me start with you because your colleague, Maggie Haberman, in the New York Times, who you have an important byline with this morning on Pence, we'll get to that in a moment, but she tweets this: sometimes the person yelling the most about leaks is doing the leaking. It's not hard to figure out who she's talking about. Good point.
Well, I'm not going to decode that specific tweet, but the issue dealing with the Trump team, you know, in the White House, but then going back to the campaign, and frankly, before he was a political candidate, is that if he's trying to root out the people who are talking furtively to the press, he's going to need to get rid of most of the people around him. This is a team. You know, this isn't a sort of situation where there's one mole in the West Wing or a couple people who are stepping out of line. That it is cultural, and the culture in many ways comes from the top. Mm-hmm. That people who work for Trump look out for themselves and they push their agenda in the media. And in some ways, the president makes a lot of noise in a sort of outraged way, but he also kind of rewards people for making their case through the press. Well, he takes his cues
and
from
watches
television.
It and consumes it that way. And It's an effective way to communicate with him. We've heard from a number of folks close to the president. Bianca, to you, this is, as Suzanne said, day six of the controversy over White House aide Kelly Sadler's disgusting remarks about John McCain dying. The White House could have dealt with this differently. They chose to not apologize publicly. They chose to try to flip this, make it a story about leaks. How would you assess the White House's job thus far on getting a hold of a story that has been crippling even among leading Republicans in Congress?
Yeah, look, another self-inflicted wound. We've been here before. I mean, this didn't even come from the mouth of the president, right? You would think the cleanup would be swift and it would have been a one-day story. Come out and say she was joking. Yep. She apologized. We don't condone this type of language, even if it was a joke, and it won't happen again, and that's that. But we've seen this time and time before. We've seen this with Rob Porter. We've seen this in a number of instances where the administration, starting, one would assume, from the president, because he chose to finally address this issue, not on the comments that she made, but on the leaking now that they want to focus on, they dig in their heels.
But can he do that, Alex, at lunch today? If he has senators, Cornyn and Thune pressing him on ZTE and other senators pressing him on, the McCain, why was this allowed to happen, comments like this in your White House? Can he really just say, oh, no, nothing there, this is just a problem of leakers?
He certainly can say that, and then it's sort of up to Republican senators to press him on it, that the president has moved on from many of these controversies simply by refusing to address it, right? Denying that it happened in some cases or saying basically this is not
important. But McCain has, if you agree with his politics or not, has a special place in the hearts of so many Americans and so many of his fellow Republicans and Democrats in the Senate. Isn't this different?
There's no question that it's different. What I wonder, and we'll see in a couple hours, is who is the member of the Republican conference in the Senate who is going to take it to the president to his face? Because we've not seen anybody basically
to this point.
To be crude, I think maybe you'll hear from the president if you start to see his base turning on this. Right now, you don't seem to see that impacting him at all. Mm-hmm. You don't seem to see his base reacting. And this is a president that seems to be more focused on his base and expanding to other voters.
Alex, quickly, on your reporting in the New York Times today, that Trump aides are worried because the Vice President Mike Pence appears to be staging a power grab for the Republican Party. There were so many sort of striking examples and stories throughout of how that is happening. What kind of tension, how much tension is this actually causing in the West Wing?
Well, look, what we see right now is that amid all the chaos on the Trump side of the West Wing, the vice president and some of his senior staffers have annexed just a huge amount of influence when it comes to the levers of power in the Republican Party, fundraising, candidate endorsements, how the party deploys its resources and its strategy in the midterms. And this is alarming to folks on the Trump side of the West Wing, both because they think the president sort of deserves his own power base and they think that everybody beneath the president ought to stay within that power base, and also because there are some pretty vivid examples when it comes to important elections in states like Florida and Texas of the vice president rewarding his own allies, taking care of his own interests, and potentially heading off his own political competitors, for 2024 or sooner.
Very disciplined, too.
Yeah. It's a fascinating read. I would suggest it. New York Times this morning. Thank you both.